Good morning and welcome to the 26th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2023. I've received apologies for today's meeting from Stephanie Callaghan and David Torrance, and we're joined by James Dornan, MSP. The first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 to 7 in private. Are members agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you. The second item on our agenda is a session as part of the committee's pre-budget scrutiny ahead of the publication of the Scottish Budget for 2024-25. For this morning's session, I welcome to the meeting Carmen Martinez, Coordinator of Scottish Women's Budget Group, Professor David Wolfe, Commissioner of Scottish Fiscal Commission, and Philip White, Director of IPPR Scotland. And we will move straight to questions. Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. My question for Professor Wolfe, please. The SFC have projected that health spending will increase from 35% of devolved spending in 2027-2028 to 50% in 2072-73. My question is, what actions can the Scottish Government take now to stop that from happening? Thank you.
Let me just make two points. First of all, it is not our role as the Commission to advise the Scottish Government on policy. We simply produce the forecasts of what likely spending and tax revenue would be. And any decisions about policy are for MPs and the Government to make. It would help you, I can talk you through some of the drivers behind that growth in the share of spending. So what we're projecting here is that spending on health will grow faster than other elements of spending over that 50-year period. And there are a number of factors behind that projected growth. One factor is that because of technical progress in the rest of the economy, that will drive up wages. In the health sector, a lot of the technical progress that takes place is not specifically reducing the manpower inputs into work. I mean, some of it does, so if you replace normal surgery with keyhole surgery, that means patients have to be in hospital a lot less long. And that means there's less cost involved in looking after them. But a lot of the progress that takes place in the health sector is about developing new techniques to solve previously untreatable conditions or to improve the treatment of other conditions. But the problem is you still have to pay the doctors and the high-calibre nurses you're employing wages that match those that are in the private sector. So your costs of hiring the labour are going up, but you're not getting the benefits of reducing the labour inputs into the process. So that's one factor driving the increase in costs. Another factor is simply that as you make, through new discoveries and new technical progress, as you discover new ways of treating people, then obviously you will be treating conditions that you previously weren't treating before. And so the amount of treatment you will be doing will go up for that reason. So that's another factor driving up cost. A third factor is the increase of chronic conditions like obesity, diabetes, etc. So, for example, there were forecasts produced by the Institute for Fiscal Studies that said that the growth in people with a chronic condition has been grown by 4%, which is higher than population growth as a whole. So a higher fraction of the population are suffering from at least one chronic condition. But the number of people suffering from multiple chronic conditions has been growing by 8% over time. So the number of people with chronic conditions and multiple chronic conditions has been growing, and that's another factor driving up the costs of health spending. a factor which you might think would be driving it up might be demography. So what's happening in Scotland is that, in common with many other countries, we have an ageing population, but we also have a declining population, which is less common. So what's been happening in the past is that the Scottish population has been growing because of the declining birth rate has been matched by increases in immigration. But now the decline of birth rate has got to the level that has not been matched by immigration. So we're projecting that over the next 50 years, the population in Scotland will actually be falling. And the way that pans out in terms of health spending is that the ageing of the population will be driving up expenditure on health in the earlier parts of that 50-year period. But then towards the end of that 50-year period, the fact you've got falling populations will tend to reduce the rate of growth of health spending. So demography is playing a small part, but it's playing a part of increasing the growth in spending early in the period, but reducing the growth of spending later in the period. So if that helps you to understand the forces that are driving it.
Thank you. And on that figure, it's almost as though 4% seems a very important figure. The SFC's fiscal sustainability report helped to inform the Scottish Government's decision to apply a higher growth rate of 4% to health and social care expenditure. In your view, and given the wide-ranging pressures on the NHS, is the 4% high enough?
Again, let me just repeat, we do not comment on policy, whether it's the right policy or the wrong policy. Our role is simply to advise the government on what the spending and tax consequences are of its policies. I'm sorry I can't help you further.
That's fine. And I'll go to my final question for Philip White, if I may, please. Audit Scotland have highlighted many times that the NHS is not being run in a financially or operationally sustainable way, even before the COVID-19 pandemic. So the question is, do existing resources need to be deployed differently or more effectively, in your view?
So I want to make sure my microphone is on. Thank you. I suppose I could sort of come back to your first question to David and answering that one as well. And ultimately, I think what this all comes down to is preventative spend. So, you know, we're more than a decade on from Christie, and yet ultimately the kind of the vision that Christie set continues to be an ambition rather than actually being met, and we may come back to prevention at some point. But as David said, I think he's helped set out the drivers quite clearly. But we know that Scotland's population is due to decline over the next 20 years. But also over the next 20 years, you're going to see a corresponding increase in the annual disease burden. So we are getting sicker. We're getting older as a population. We're getting sicker. And a result of getting sicker, we're also getting poorer as a nation. And again, we may come back to some of this. So that's ultimately where this driver is coming from, that we are still continuing to deploy resources to deal with the consequences of quite often preventable and amenable mortality and preventable disease. And that's the situation we're stuck in. We're kind of constantly deploying reactive spend to things that could have been proactively addressed much earlier. So while the resource is right now within the system, I think the other thing we might come back to is obviously workforce and staffing. We know that a huge proportion of health board budgets and operating costs are taken up with staff costs. And indeed, that's where a huge chunk of obviously the increases over the last couple of years in particular have gone. Staff are our biggest asset and resource, so I don't think that, you know, you'd say that those resources aren't being deployed in the right way. But clearly, if we want to continue to grow the workforce, that's going to add increased burden and increased pressures onto the budget. So I'm not sure I've actually given a good answer to your question there. I think, you know, because you're into then kind of how hospitals and health boards are deploying resources, and that's probably beyond my area of expertise in terms of how they're deploying every pound and penny. But I think the overall kind of summation is that, going back to that point, we need to continue to put additional resources in because there are huge pressures that have built up in the system. Those are pressures that existed long before COVID, albeit that might have exacerbated it. But there are also pressures that, if at some point we have started to shift our resources into a preventative spend model, you have the, you know, huge potential to have ensured that they didn't come to pass.
Thank you. I'm now going to move to Karen Walken, who joins us remotely.
Thank you, Convener. I'm interested, you know, following on from the discussion that you've had there about preventative spend, and, you know, I suppose one of my questions is there enough being done to achieve sort of transformational change in the service, considering the financial sort of instability the health service is in? I wonder if you might be able to follow on from that.
And you, just for the panel, you don't need to press your button. That will be done by broadcasting.
Okay, thank you. Right, good morning, everyone. So the Scottish Women's Budget Group has long called for greater investment in the care sector particularly, and for care to be placed at the core of economic recovery after the pandemic. Our asks, in a briefing that we published at the beginning of the year, our asks go beyond plans established in the National Care Service Bill 2022, because we argue that higher wages and expanding workforce are key for staff recruitment and retention. We also consider that greater investment in care is crucial to meet current unmet needs, with a focus on quality as well as on prevention. So when we modelled this cost of care in Scotland, we took into consideration who needs care, the intensity and type of care provision, and how much care costs, including care workers' wages. And by looking at these areas, we identify a core scenario that we thought is the bare minimum, or like a base that we should build from. However, the modelling goes further to presenting a transformative investment scenario as required to re-envision and reconfigure care in Scotland. So this is where I'm addressing the question. So the core scenario, which focuses on ensuring current substantial needs are covered by increasing the number of care recipients by about 20%, and this would meet current unmet needs and extend free provision to all types of care, so including household tasks. This core scenario also aims to increase pay rates to the more competitive wage of £12.50 an hour, and the model estimates that this would cost £5,094 million in 2022-23 prices, which is £1,500 million above the current budgeted level of net spending on adult social care. The transformative scenario, though, so we said that this would be the minimum that we would like to kind of like start with, or the base, but we should work towards a transformative scenario, and the briefing that we published kind of like sets the path to achieve this transformative scenario. And that would focus on increasing access to free care to those with moderate needs, as well as increasing qualifications and pay to Nordic levels, with care workers paid an average of £15.21 per hour. And in this scenario, higher take-up rates are assumed that would relieve informal care needs further and eliminate unmet needs. And this would require £6,822 million in annual public investment, or 3.7% of GDP, a 1.8% increase on the current budget. That is nearly doubling public investment in care. One of the reasons, there are different reasons behind why we think that this investment is important. One of the reasons is we think that this would lead to greater equality, gender equality outcomes. 83% of the workforce in the care sector are female. So higher wages would create this more gender equality outcomes, and it will help with recruitment and retention within the sector. We also think that this is important to comply with fair work, and there was another reason behind this, and I just forgot about it, but it will come to me.
Do you mind if I come in?
Yes.
I really appreciate the information that you've given us. I suppose my question would be, given, you know, the pressures, financial pressures, post-pandemic backlog, you know, the transformation into the potential for a national care service, do you think it's realistic that we can do that sort of in a single year settlement, or do you think we need more, you know, maybe a multi-year settlement? You know, is there other things that we need to do to achieve this?
Thank you. I remember what I wanted to say, and is that another reason behind why we should invest more on care is because of the preventative approach by looking after people before they get very sick. That should prevent lengthy stays at hospital. So again, that would alleviate pressures on the NHS. Looking at the costings or forecast will certainly help, but perhaps we need to ask ourselves if we can afford not to do something about it, or if we can afford not to invest in it.
Thank you. I wonder if I could ask one of the other panel members just about the way in which the settlements happen and whether that is putting... The boards are definitely telling us that they have, you know, they foresee problems in meeting their, you know, their current requirements. So do you think if we had a different approach that that might be helpful?
Yeah, I think two things. So we know that multi-year budgeting helps across a huge range of organisations in terms of planning, in terms of being able to figure out where you're spending your money long term. I think that's a really good, to bring it back to the elective backlog, which you mentioned, I think that's a prime example. So, you know, we know that obviously the targets that the Scottish Government set in the Tenancy Recovery Plan across both inpatient and outpatients still aren't being met. So we still have huge amounts of people waiting longer for elective care. I think it was Audit Scotland that rightly flagged that there was some concern about, just given the timescales, which are partly understandable, that the recovery plan was put together, the extent to which boards had a say in terms of how those targets were derived. But equally, those targets were national level targets. It was an overall, this is how much we want capacity and output to increase at a macro level in Scotland by 2026. But we know that, again, things like waiting lists have huge variations across the country, across health boards, across specialties, across everything. So being able to derive a national level target without knowing how that would be delivered by who, where and when at a local level obviously shows a huge disconnect. If you then remove funding from that and have a disconnect on how much money health boards will have each year, that makes the job even more difficult. So I think just on something like that, it shows that rather than having a national level top down approach, actually having a bottom up approach where you can start to determine what your capacity and need is at a local level, and then in turn what funding is required to deliver that over a much longer period, is how you ultimately arrive at being able to meet those kind of long term outcomes rather than an annual cyclical basis.
Wait, thanks. I've got one last question, convener, if that's okay. The first speaker mentioned sort of a use of technology. There's something that's repeatedly brought up with the committee as sort of digital and our capacity in terms of digital speaking to each other, and obviously as well just the investment we need in that. Do you think enough has been done by government to try and support health boards with that?
Well, again, that's not something which was in our capacity to talk about. If I could just explain, what we do in the Fiscal Commission is we produce budget forecasts, but those budget forecasts just cover the revenue from devolved taxes, primarily the Scottish income tax, the non-savings, non-dividend income tax, and we also forecast spending on social security. We do that both for the 1 year ahead budgets, 1 year ahead forecast for the budget, and also in May each year we produce a 5 year forecast to look at some of these issues about how you plan spending over a 5 year period. But again, that doesn't cover health. The only time we've actually done any projections on health spending was for the fiscal sustainability report that the first questioner was asking about. So we don't get into any details of modelling and forecasting health spending. So some of these more specific questions about technology that you're asking about are not things which we actually have the knowledge and expertise to advise you on in any detail, I'm afraid.
Thank you very much. Thanks, convener.
Thank you, Carol. I'm now going to move to Paul Sweeney.
Thanks very much to the panel for their contributions so far today. We have discussed pay pressures in the NHS and general financial pressures, the Scottish Government agreed a pay offer of 6.5% for most NHS staff for 23-24, and particularly a 12.4% increase for junior doctors, but nonetheless payroll pressures continue to persist as a structural issue and challenge for the National Health Service. Mr White, you mentioned that wages do take up a lot of spend, but it's about balancing that whilst also recruiting new staff and indeed retaining staff who may bleed overseas or to external agencies, for example. How do we strike that balance? Is there any insights you might have about how well current boards are performing in that regard, or indeed national pay bargaining is performing in that regard, and how it's potentially structurally adrift from where we need to be?
I'm afraid in the substance, probably not, and definitely probably wouldn't want to cut across what I'd imagine what would be a very robust answer that trade union colleagues would give you. So definitely don't want to step on their toes. But as I say, like, I think the general point stands. So it's, you know, just over two thirds of, in, you know, just in hospitals and hospital sector, just over two thirds of operating costs are taken up by pay. And again, as I said before, that is not unexpected. Staff are our biggest resource, our biggest asset. You know, it's understandable and it's right that kind of we ensure that pay is being able to match, that we can recruit and retain the absolute best staff. But I think then it becomes a question of what does that leave left over for the wider work that needs to be done, and is the balance right? And if we think that it isn't, then I don't think the lesson that anyone would take from the last couple of years in particular is that you look to restrict staff numbers or reduce pay. It's that the other end of the scale, those non-staff costs need to increase to make up the balance.
Okay, that's helpful. Do you have any insights, anyone on the panel, on how this is benchmarked against other healthcare systems in the developed world, perhaps?
Could I maybe just make a slightly different point in answer to your question, which is about how these pay increases will get funded. A lot of this depends on what happens in the rest of the UK, because health is a devolved spending power. A lot will depend on the Barnett consequentials that flow from whatever settlements are made by the UK government. So if the UK government settles at roughly the same level as the Scottish government, and if it does that by increasing budgets, then all that will flow through to Scotland through the consequentials. So the net impact on the Scottish budget could be quite low. But if the UK government settles at a much lower level than the Scottish government has done, or if it chooses not to increase any funding, it just says we will fund this out of existing budgets, then there will be very little increase in consequentials. So all the pay increases agreed in Scotland will have to fall on the Scottish budget. So the way this is going to impact on the Scottish budget will depend to some extent on what happens in the rest of the UK, how these, what levels they settle at, and whether they increase budgets in order to pay that increase in wages in the rest of the UK. It's just something to bear in mind when you're thinking about the year ahead and the budgeting for a year ahead.
Did Ms Martinez have a point to make?
About your question about benchmark with other countries?
It did look like you were just about to come in.
No, sorry.
All right, we're not. Okay, sorry.
Sorry, thank you for the computer. Thank you. And it's just more of a general point. I should say it's not in response to any particular questioning, but I think it's probably a wider point actually that brings together the discussion we've had on preventative spend, discussion on staffing, which is the balance of where we're putting our resources. So if you just take staffing, over the last 5 years, the NHS Scotland workforce has grown by over 12%. That is understandable, to be expected. The corresponding increase in the GP whole time equivalent over the last 3 years, so different time periods, is a decrease of 3%. And I think this speaks to a wider point that, you know, we talk about the health service, but actually what we're quite often talking about is secondary care, which continues to dominate the debate, dominates resources, dominates attention. Whereas actually, if you want to talk about shifting to a preventative model, actually primary care and community health is where you see the biggest returns. I'm conscious we've got a GP in the room, so we may come back to this at some point. But I think it's, I suppose it's just more of that general point that there is a continued domination of secondary care, which again is understandable to where some of the most significant pressures are. But just in terms of that staff resource, funding resource, everything else, actually you can see that that balance of where we're delivering care is still very much stuck in a secondary first model, rather than actually starting to look at what we can do to bolster the role of primary care, which when you start to think about health inequalities, about, you know, tackling diseases before they take root, and those wider kind of, you know, social prescribing, social issues, actually, again, that's where you see some of your greatest returns.
Can I just ask as a follow-up about the potential consequences of capital investment as well? Do you see an issue with capital investment versus, you know, productivity enhancements vis-a-vis labour intensivity in the system?
I'm afraid the capital programme is again an area that's not within my expertise,
okay.
I'm afraid.
No problem.
Apologies.
Okay.
I'm going to come to Emma Harper for a supplementary on this issue.
Thank you. Thanks. It's for Philip White. Just going along with the conversation, I've got bits of paper in front of me about preventative approaches, and I know Henry Dimbleby's written a lot about ultra-high processed foods, and the work of Professor Pekka Puska in Finland, reducing the mortality of people by a whole system approach, getting restaurants, cafes, supermarkets involved in providing healthier choices that are affordable for people. So, you know, I'm thinking about preventative spend rather than just secondary care, fighting fires, you know, constantly. So something has to shift with the way we invest to stop folk getting into the hospital in the first place, to stop people being sick. Our non-communicable disease paper that came out, it's a cross-party approach where colleagues Gillian Mackay, Carl Mochan and Sanjesh Galhani and Faisal Chowdhury, we've been part of this cross-party approach to look at non-communicable diseases which contribute around 53,000 deaths in 2022 in Scotland. So, you know, something needs to be done different, right? What would you suggest we cut out something in order to move funding to preventative spend? Because there is only one pot of money, and it's a real challenge to figure what would we need to do differently.
So this is some context. We did some analysis earlier this year looking at the social and economic harms of poverty. So we looked across a number of public services, but also looked at the economic impacts. So just within health boards, so not even the wider health budget, just within health board spending, our analysis indicated that around £2.3 billion of health board budget is responding to the consequences of poverty. So that isn't things like higher avoidable disease, mortality and everything else. So huge amounts every single year are going in. But yeah, you've hit the nail on the head. You know, whenever we released that report, the question everyone asked was, where will this money come from? Because there's a seesaw that every pound that you put into preventative spend is a pound that you have to take from somewhere else. But I think it's back to long-term budgeting, you know, multi-year budgeting, that we've been having that debate about Christie for more than a decade now. So that's more than a decade of time that we have lost and starting to shift that balance. So if we had started at that point, actually, again, you'd be seeing huge returns today. So it's really tricky, and I don't have an answer of where you start to kind of put that money in. The one I always have to come back to, you know, obviously you've got a commitment to put all health consequentials into frontline health spending. But, you know, that can range that some years, that is, you know, hundreds of millions, if not billions. Some years it's low hundreds of millions. So if you're talking, you know, a couple hundred million in health consequentials, putting it into the overall health budget, actually it's a tiny drop in the ocean. If you took that money and put it instead into something like, you know, getting every homeless person off the streets in Scotland, you know, something that actually has a direct impact on people's lives, things like that can have a huge contribution towards starting to tackle those longer-term health inequalities. But I think that's the problem. I think it is potentially, again, that dominance of secondary care in the debates that we have. And again, it's understandable given the huge pressures and backlogs that exist in the system. Absolutely every spur, penny and pounds, you know, can absolutely be directed at fighting that backlog and tackling it and bringing it down. But I do think we missed that opportunity to start thinking about, actually, if we started putting our money into homelessness, into social security, into good quality housing, those are all things that we know have that long-term and direct impact on those kind of health inequalities that continue to blight Scotland, that continue to kind of, you continue to see those huge variations between the most and least deprived areas. So it is incredibly difficult, but it's one of those ones that you need to start at some point, and the longer we put it off, we know how much more likely it is that those inequalities continue to persist, and those kind of projections around avoidable mortality and communicable disease and everything else come to pass.
And I know we're probably going to come to poverty and tackling poverty, but do you think there's a role? Like, we have certain things are reserved to UK government. There's items that health is devolved, but the money isn't. So I'm interested in also, what role do food producers and retailers have in engaging with government to look at how we support having diets that are more, I suppose, more healthy, so that people can afford healthier food instead of the way that some of the food is marketed right now, like processed food, which is jam-packed full of calories, which doesn't tell your brain that you're satiated, so you keep eating. So there's some emerging research around this that I find pretty fascinating, but do you think there's a role for supermarkets and restaurants and cafes to work with government in order to help deliver a less obesogenic environment?
I think there has to be, and again, so this is where quite often, and it's the same across things, so like, you know, poverty. I will go and talk to Social Justice Committee, and quite often, you know, it's centred around what can government do, the role of social security, but actually with an issue like poverty, you need to be asking what employers can do in terms of fair work and pay. Exactly the same applies right across all areas of public policy. I think we need to stop viewing things in a very siloed nature, that this is not just a health problem. This is a problem that supermarkets, that employers, that housing associations, that landlords, et cetera, all have a role to play, because again, we know that the consequences of poverty are ill health and those health inequalities that we continue to see. And that's not something that health service can solve. It's something that health service can only deal with the consequences of until we start shifting the balance of the care that we're providing, where we're providing it, and also then those wider kind of public services.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, convener.
And Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. Professor, very briefly, can I ask... Sorry, just before I do that, my declaration of interest as a practising NHS GP. Professor, very briefly, can I ask to clarify what you said to Paul Sweeney earlier about the increase in staff pay? That increase in staff pay is going to lead to a cut in other aspects of NHS spend in Scotland.
Sorry, I didn't quite catch your question.
Sorry?
I didn't quite catch your question.
So, from what you've said to Paul Sweeney earlier,
yep.
To clarify, the increase in staff pay in Scotland
yep.
is going to lead to a cut in NHS budgets and NHS spend elsewhere. Is that what you said?
No, it's not what I said. I said something slightly different, which was that in healthcare, a lot of the progress we make through new technological developments tends to come in the form of better treatments for patients, ways to treat conditions that weren't previously treatable. It doesn't come so much in the form of kind of labour-saving progress, where you're reducing the number of workers you need in order to deliver a given level of health. In some areas, that's the case. I gave the example of keyhole surgery, where if you use keyhole surgery, there's less time involved in keeping the patient in hospital and less resource. So my point was more that you have to keep on recruiting staff who are out from other areas of work, and they're going to benefit from the increases in wages that they get through technical progress. So you have to match those wage increases outside the health sector in order to carry on attracting staff, but you're not getting the corresponding reductions in the number of staff you need to treat patients. So that's driving up your costs of treating patients. That was the point I was trying to make.
Thank you. And Philip, you said twice that staffing is our biggest resource and our biggest cost, which is obviously true. But can I ask, and I don't know if you're able to answer it, or Professor David, you're able to answer this, but what's our spend on NHS managers?
So I don't have that figure to hand. I started to look, so that 12.9% is obviously the overall NHS workforce, which includes administrative staff, managerial staff, etc. I did start to break the numbers down, so I had them to hand yesterday and then didn't get a chance to. So I'm not too sure on what spend or proportion of staffing is in that. I think there's a point that I kind of absolutely kind of get where you're coming from, the frontline staff, those delivering care, the most important. Obviously, you need to make sure that our hospitals, everything else, are well run. You know, that does require managerial staff, so I certainly wouldn't make any judgments about whether or not the balance there is too high or not. But yeah, I don't have those figures to hand.
Seeing as you were working on it, could you send them through? That would be okay. Thank you.
Thank you. And I'm actually going to come back to Sandesh Gohani to move on to our next theme.
Thank you. Again, sorry, coming back to you, Philip. In response to Tess White, you spoke about preventative medicine, and as a GP, obviously, I'm going to come on to talk about this. So, you know, I think that we must transform the way we think about and deliver healthcare. We can't keep focusing on health with what we do now. We can't treat the NHS like a bike repair shop where people just come in and get repaired. We need to get them better beforehand. And organisations like the British Society of Lifestyle Medicine are advocating for this preventative agenda. I know you spoke about it earlier, but I'd just like you to expand, and could you give us some tangible examples of where we could implement preventative spend, where the things that we could do within healthcare budgets to achieve this?
Yeah. So there's probably public health led measures like Emma was talking about, which actually again need to exist out with the health service. You look at standards in housing. Again, we know that the housing stock is most likely to be substandards for people living in poverty in more deprived areas. We know again that low standards in housing can give rise to things like respiratory diseases. I'm sure you've probably seen it being presented in surgeries and everything else. So, you know, there's those, it's the non-health service bit that, again, actually, I don't think we've tackled yet. And we either talk about, we often talk about this as an issue of poverty, so we'll try to address it as an issue of poverty, but we quite often still don't make those connections with, it's not until health inequality stats come out every year that we go, oh, yeah, actually, there's a big link between health inequalities and deprivation. But we don't think to address those things as a matter of, as a health issue, we continue to address them as a social issue. So I think being able to do those things, like with the health service. I think if you look within the health system, you know, again, there has been good innovations over the last couple of years. So the multidisciplinary teams that have been formed, you know, there's evidence to suggest that the outcomes still haven't been fantastic, but I think at least at an anecdotal, and if not in delivering better health outcomes yet, in being able to bring those professionals together and be able to start to coordinate the advice and the services that they're providing is really important, not least in particular with the inclusion of mental health, because again, we know there's been a huge rise in mental ill health over the last few years. And again, it's got huge corresponding impacts on things like participation in the labour market and everything else. So those have shown a good example of where you can start to bring resources together within communities. That potentially then gives rise to the development of more hub and spoke type models, where you've got a really strong central hub within a community, but ensuring that then actually what your GP services has become is about being able to provide continuity of care. So again, I think if you look at experience surveys, if you look at obviously the implication of kind of resourcing over the last few years, and again, you may have personal experience of this, what we know is that one of the first things that can give within primary care, and particularly within GP practices, is that continuity of care, and the same GP isn't able to provide care to the same patient every single time because resources are so stretched. So that kind of hub and spoke model potentially then gives rise to being able to allow GPs to focus on that much more, and you've got a much stronger centre. You look at things like community link workers. I think if you talk to any kind of any health professional that is a part of those, but in particular those deep end GP practices that obviously have been at the forefront of their development, they have had a hugely beneficial role, again, in providing that kind of more social prescribing, not in health support, which, again, we know quite often GPs can become burdens. Burdens is not the right word to use, but people are often presenting with those non-health issues. Again, community link workers present a brilliant resource there. But obviously, again, we've seen reports over the last few months of the risk to staffing numbers among CLWs, in particular in those local authorities where they're needed most, like Glasgow. So I think those are the sorts of things that I think we should be looking at doing more. There's probably further innovations that, again, go beyond kind of my area of expertise. But I think what it all comes down to is having that, whether you call it a multidisciplinary team, whether you call it hub and spoke, well, whatever you call it, ensuring that we start to bring those wider resources much closer to communities that can play that role in tackling the causes and being able to prevent them much earlier, whilst ensuring that we free up GPs to be able to provide that continuing care and be able to provide that kind of friendly face, is such a cliched way to put it, but being able to do that to ensure that kind of everyone has access to that continuity of care is really important.
And, you know, I couldn't agree more about what you say about GPs. It's really important that you know, when I'm doing my job as a GP, I want to be sure that I'm helping people's health and not trying to focus on their social issues, because there are other people who are probably better placed to do that. And you brought up community link workers, and in Glasgow, we're going to see deep cuts made to community link workers. And I've received a lot of correspondence from community link workers. I've gone and spoken to deep end practices. I've spoken to GPs who are stopping in the street talking about this. Because the good that they do is huge. But the worry that a lot of my community link workers that have responded are saying to me that if they're cut, they're going to have to go from one practice to three practices. They'll have a day a week maybe in each practice, and that will significantly hinder the work that they will be able to do to the community. So what value should we be placing on these community link workers, especially in our most deprived areas?
So again, I'm very conscious that I don't want to dominate proceedings here. So hopefully we can have someone else come in at some point. I think it comes back to that point that I don't think we would have the same debate about, or the same risk to community link workers that we would have around staffing in any other part of the system. Because again, what we continue to do is prioritise. And again, I understand it, and this is not to say that anything about it, but we continue to kind of, attention and focus goes on the secondary system. And primary care and community-led care continues to kind of very much be a distant runner-up in that debate. We need to absolutely start recognising the importance of things like link workers, again, things like multidisciplinary teams, actually deep-end practices themselves, being able to kind of celebrate the role that they play much more. And I just don't think we're there yet, because I still don't think we've cracked that kind of nut of the recognition of the important role that we place on community-led care. And being able to ensure that not that it starts to dominate over secondary care, but we start to recognise that actually the health system is at least three or four different bits, and each of them needs to be as well resourced and kind of as respected and as part of the solution as any other. But I don't think we're there yet, because I think, again, it comes back to that. We still quite often do not see social issues as health issues and vice versa, or at least not to the extent to which we should.
Thank you. I'm aware that other people want to come into this. This is my last question. And I'm sorry, I'm sticking with you here, because about 80 to 90% of all patient contacts happens in primary care. That's where people access healthcare. And you're right when you say we're not quite there when it comes to the resourcing. It is dominated by secondary care. And we've seen a £65 million cut in the primary care budget last year. So with that happening, how are we expecting our GPs to provide a service that does enable this preventative agenda? How can we get our GPs to have the time to ask about things like alcohol or cigarettes or, you know, other questions, as opposed to the only thing that comes through the door? Do you have any ways that we could maybe do that?
Firstly, on the funding point, I think so. There's been lots of attention placed to the overall commitment to increase the overall health budget by 20%, which was originally by the end of this parliament, and obviously has been met already. There's potentially a question there of whether or not that was, you know, was that a commitment that was made because they were confident of being met, or actually was it a much needed increase this early in the parliament? And actually, it needs to go much further than 20%. But I think what also gets forgotten is that in its first programme for government of this parliament, the Scottish Government also committed to increasing primary spend by 25% over this parliament, and then at least half of all frontline spend going into community health. The opacity of primary funding, community health funding, means that I'm not sure whether or not that commitment is being met, or what that looks like, or what success looks like. So I think that's part of the problem as well, is that quite often we don't know where the money is going in primary care, because it's not as simple of here is a health board and I'm going to give you your budget now. So yeah, it's just a point on funding that there are equally big funding commitments for primary care, but I'm not sure of the extent to which they're being met in the same way that kind of the overall health budget is. And then the secondary point, again, it's a question of whose role is it? And again, I would imagine that you would say that it's not a GP's role to be providing those kinds of services. And I think that's where we need to start thinking about alternative delivery models. That ensuring that we can free up GPs to be able to provide that continuing care, to be able to ensure that they are able to kind of see the same patients, know what their history is, know what their needs are, and then having that wider support network within surgeries. So again, we've got things like the commitment to ensure that every GP practice has a mental health worker by the end of this parliament. You know, those are really important commitments, and we need to ensure that they're being met, because ensuring that kind of that people within communities know where they can go for that source of advice, that we've got no wrong door approaches, that we've got kind of holistic services being provided in one place, so we, you know, people don't have to go all over the place to be able to provide that support, is incredibly important. So I don't even know if it's about who is providing it. What is probably the most important thing is where it's being provided, and the assurance that if you go and seek it, you will be able to access it.
Thank you.
Yeah, I'm going to move on to another MSP. So Gillian Mackay, who joins us remotely.
Thanks, convener, and good morning to the panel. If I could come back to Philip White and something that we picked up with Emma Harper earlier on around prevention and preventing people from falling into poverty and having enough money to live on in the first place. With that in mind, what impact does the panel believe the introduction of a universal basic income or a minimum income guarantee could have on the health and social care system in terms of reducing strain and costs?
Okay, let me just say, again, our remit in the Fiscal Commission is we cannot comment on new policies. We can only comment on policies that have been produced by the Scottish Government. But just to maybe make my point that I was about to make, there is an important interaction between spending on health and spending in other areas of government. This is, goes back to your vice versa point. So we do observe that because of the increase in waiting lists in the NHS, that's showing up in spending on social security, particularly disability benefits. And now 40% of disability benefits arise because of mental health issues. So the more you can get better delivery of healthcare, that has important implications for spending on social security. And also, there's some evidence now that it might increase participation rates in the economy. And so you get more people working, you get higher levels of GDP, higher levels of income, a point that Carmen was making earlier on. And so tax revenue can potentially go up. So I think it's really important that we see the overlap between health, what's going on in health, what's going on in social security, what's going on in tax, and we take that more holistic picture of what's happening in government, which goes back to your point about the important interactions between these things. I'm sorry I didn't quite answer your question, Gillian.
I think I'll try to contribute. So regarding the minimum income guarantee, we know We know that socioeconomic factors have implications for health inequalities. I think we've seen that with austerity for the last 10, 13 years, and there is a wealth of evidence that links austerity with health inequalities. And from the survey that we ran at the beginning of the year and other surveys that we've run with civil society organisations, we've seen that, for example, in the case of women, they are already using different strategies to be able to face or to navigate the cost of living crisis. So again, the cost of living crisis will have an impact on poverty, and this will have an impact on future spending and pressures on the NHS as well. So key findings, for example, 70% of the women that responded to our survey, and the total was 871, said that they have not been putting heating on to reduce costs, and almost 20% of respondents are skipping meals entirely. This increases to almost 34% for disabled women and 46% for single parents. Regarding care costs, some women have also said to us that they have struggled to meet these or to afford them. We also know that provision hasn't got back to what it was prior to the pandemic. We also know that some women are struggling to attend health appointments due to the cost of transport. So again, the minimum income guarantee, as long as it's well thought out and it provides the minimum, could help to at least absorb some of the consequences that the current economic situation is having on people and on women particularly.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you. I'm now going to move on to Paul Sweeney.
Thanks, Convener, and thank you to the panel for their contribution. The committee recently invited views on winter planning in the National Health Service, and many submissions suggested that the development of a whole systems approach is hindered by the short-term nature of planning and funding. Do any of the panel members have a view on how we can achieve a whole systems approach in any practical sense?
It's not something we've covered.
So I'm sorry. I don't think so. Okay. The IPPR's recent report on social and economic harm of poverty in Scotland has highlighted the reactive spending cycle as an avoidable one. Do you have a view on how we disrupt that cycle and transition to an increase in preventative spending against the backdrop of such acute pressures on secondary services?
Yeah, I think this quite covered lots of this in response to Emma's question earlier. It is a delicate balance. I think actually David's highlighted a really big problem here as well, which is that, I can sit here and say we need to shift the balance of spend, but actually we also need to ensure that we're still spending and tackling the elective backlog, because we know that the longer people spend on a waiting list, the poorer that their health becomes and the greater likelihood is that they exit the labour market if they were in it to start with. And we've already seen a kind of rise in chronic and long-term conditions, which again has resulted in us getting poorer. So it is an incredibly difficult kind of seesaw to start to try and balance. I think as I go back to some of the kind of responses earlier, there is an issue of looking within the health service, so ensuring that we're getting that balance between the resources we're putting into primary and the resources we're putting into secondary care right. Because again, primary care will often treat the causes, whereas secondary will treat the consequences. And then secondly, ensuring that in our wider social policy spending, so again, things like housing, things like social security, that we're recognising responding to it as much as a health issue as it is an issue of poverty, because health inequalities in particular are a matter of poverty and vice versa. So it probably doesn't really matter which way you approach it from, do you approach it as a health issue or an issue of poverty? But I think just starting to recognise that the two are intertwined and we start to kind of tackle them as such.
Do you have any examples of either instances of service provision within Scotland or in other countries where that transition has been managed and showed promising signs?
We looked at some as part of UK-wide research, so I don't have it immediately to hand because it was UK-wide rather than from IPR Scotland specifically, but certainly happy. We looked at kind of a different, couple of different models for kind of primary care and where that preventative shift had taken place, so happy to kind of provide it in a follow-up submission.
Thank you. That's great.
And Emma Harper.
Thanks. It's just kind of on the back of other questions that have been asked already. In the IPPR report, Philip, it's tipping the scales of social and economic harms of poverty. It says in section 2 that important action has been taken within devolved powers, demonstrating what can be achieved with political will and investment, and particularly following the devolution of new welfare powers and establishment of Social Security Scotland. And it, there's like 12 new benefits, which are more than £1 billion, I think. Council tax reduction, Scottish Child Payment, Best Start Grant. And a lot of these are like outside the health portfolio. And we know that ministers in the Scottish Government, like Housing Minister, Health Minister, Mental Health, they've all got their own portfolios, but everything crosses over if we're looking at health and health improvement. So I'm interested in, I suppose, the way that we look at the budget. How do we then, I suppose we need to value what has been set up with Social Security Scotland, fairness, dignity and respect, rather than a punitive approach, which the Department of Work and Pensions has. So I'm interested in if you think there's anything else that should be picked up in the form of like support or welfare support to help improve this safety net that we have in Scotland.
Could I just say something about social security spending, because it's a very important area. The policies you talk about, Scottish Child Payment, the reforms that have been made to the way in which particularly disability benefits are delivered, those all have spending consequences. And because of the way in which the Scottish budget operates, those are not covered by any block grant adjustment coming from the UK government. So those fall entirely on the Scottish budget. So that means that in 27-28, there'll be about £1.2 billion of spending on social care, on social security, which is not funded by block grant adjustment from the rest of the UK. About half of that arises because of spending on Scottish-only policies like Scottish Child Payment, but half of it comes from the consequences of the way in which we deliver disability benefits. So roughly half and half. By the end of the 50-year period, we project that grows to £3.2 billion. And now a large chunk of that, but £2.2 billion, comes from the reforms that have been made to the way in which Social Security is delivered, particularly through disability benefits. And about £1 billion comes from payments like Scottish Child Payment. So while all of these reforms have very good intentions, they do have fiscal consequences that fall entirely on the Scottish budget and are not coming through any block grant adjustment from the UK government. So it's just important to be aware of those costs that fall on the Scottish budget when you make these reforms.
And I think in a recent information I read, it was like Scottish Government is mitigating like £700 million of in support for things like, you know, bedroom tax, for instance, things like that.
Yep.
And, you know, I know I'm straying into politics a bit, but the Barnett formula, you know, makes adjustments for us in Scotland. But we're constrained by the way that the budget is delivered in Scotland by another government. Is that something that we maybe need to be looking at alternatives to how the Scottish Government's block grant is delivered?
Well, this is not so much... There's two elements of the block grant. One is the block grant, the permanent consequentials, which flow through to things like health, and the other are block grant adjustments, which come in two areas. One is on income tax. So what you try to do there is the Office of Budget Responsibility will try to forecast what tax revenue Scotland would have raised had it remained part of the UK tax system. So Scotland gets tax revenue that it raises, but then you subtract from that what the OBR estimates it would have raised had it remained part of the UK tax system. So had the Scottish economy and earnings grown the same way as the UK, had the tax rates been the same as in the rest of the UK. So that's the block grant adjustment relating to income tax. There's a similar block grant adjustment relating to Social Security, where essentially you're asking the question, what would have been spent in Scotland had Scotland remained part of the UK Social Security system? And that block grant is given to Scotland, but then if Scotland makes decisions, which means it spends more than that, then that increase falls entirely on the Scottish budget. So it is things like having different policies from the UK, like the Scottish child payment, that falls entirely on the Scottish budget. And it is the consequence of the reforms you make to the way in which social security is delivered that has consequences that fall on the Scottish budget. Now, there has been a review of the fiscal framework in Scotland. That was a place where some of these questions were being addressed as to how the fiscal framework operates. But under the existing fiscal framework, these are the implications of decisions that are being made by the Scottish Government and Scottish and the Parliament.
Okay. Thank you, Convener.
Paul Sweeney.
Thanks very much, Convener. The biggest commodity in the National Health Service is time. There are, of course, opportunities to boost productivity through capital investments and to tackle inefficiencies through targeted process improvements. But GPs, for example, say that they are understandably too busy firefighting to undertake any sort of innovation or process improvement. So do panel members have examples from other countries of models of innovation which have improved demonstrably productivity and helped to deliver on positive health and social care outcomes? Okay. Written submissions to the committee have noted that the short-term nature of national targets are impacting clinical priorities, with decisions made to satisfy expectations as opposed to measuring long-term impact. Do panel members have a view on alternative measures, perhaps through budgeting, that could be used to monitor performance that allow for longer-term planning? How do we shift from that short-termism to a longer-term funding and service delivery model, bearing in mind the complex interactions between Treasury and the Scottish Government?
Well, just one thing to say, that one of the reasons we published our fiscal sustainability report back in March this year, that's the first one we've done, was precisely to try to get people to understand the longer term trends that are happening on both spending and on funding and resources. By understanding that longer term trend, you can then start to think about making different decisions about how you want to prioritise spending. So that was exactly the motive for doing this. It just provides more information, more background that helps you understand the consequences of pursuing existing policies over a longer period of time. And as the convener reported earlier, the Scottish Government has already responded to our report by increasing the amount it's planning to spend on health by 4% rather than 3.5%. So that is exactly the kind of impact who are thinking that type of long-term framework of thinking will have. It will just help MPs, Parliament, government understand the long-term implications of existing policies for both funding and spending.
Thank you.
I was just going to bring quickly 2 points. So I think first on budgeting, I used to work in government, so I know what kind of, you know, it's a difficult process of setting budgets. But I think obviously you go back to, for example, the resource spending review last year, you know, we ended up with level two figures, which, you know, better than what we've previously had in terms of understanding of long-term budget outcomes or kind of potentials. But level two obviously doesn't provide you any kind of detail to know. So if you take health and social care, we got a health and social care level two budget. And I think within that, and I get that there's huge uncertainty around funding over this parliament, and we saw it last year, for example, with the mini budget, where funding went up and then down within the matter of a few weeks. It's really difficult, but you need to at least attempt to do it. And I think if you do a level two figure, one of two things has either happened. You either know your level three assumptions beneath that, but you've just chosen not to publish them, which there's potentially valid reasons for that. Or you don't know your level three figures, and actually you've got a level two figure that potentially doesn't actually have any kind of, isn't informed by actually where you're going to put that money. So I think there needs to be some attempt to try and move to a level beneath that whenever it comes to kind of that long-term budget setting. And then secondly, on targets, very quickly, I think I'd just go back to what I said before. I don't think targets are inherently wrong, albeit I know that, you know, health boards, there's a huge amount of targets now that obviously they're expected to adhere to or meet. I think I'd go back to, if you take the elective backlog, for example, that was a national level top-down target, or at least ambition that government set in its NHS recovery plan. It's good to set that, but I think all of Scotland's flagged that it's unclear the modelling that went into arriving at that national level figure. But secondly, as I said, we know that capacity, that waiting lists, everything else, specialties, all vary hugely by health board. So actually, again, what bearing does that have? What contribution are you expecting each health board to make to that national level outcome? You don't know unless you've done it from a bottom-up approach. So I think that's just the two things I would say. On funding, we need to try and drill down a level. And on targets, it's right to set them, but you need to ensure that it's formed from a bottom-up approach.
Mm. Can you just elaborate maybe on the evidence base for longer-term objective setting and setting those budgets accordingly? Because interesting examples might be health and social care partnerships, cutting a programme that without any reference back to the centre and what it might be having on national performance. Do you think we need to be doing more to improve those metrics and KPIs?
I'm not sure if we have. So at the minute, when it comes to outcomes-based budgeting, we're not there yet. And again, so, you know, again, you take the commitment at the start of this parliament to increase the health budget by 20% by the end of the parliament. That's been met already. So I'm not sure where that 20% increase came from. It's not a bad thing, obviously. It's good. But why 20%? I don't know why it was 20 and not 25, why it wasn't 15. It's been met already, so do we need to increase it now to the end of this parliament? Because actually in meeting it halfway through the parliament means that actually we underestimated the increase required. So even just at a national level, targets like that or commitments like that, ensuring that, trying to have a better understanding of the evidence base that's informed them and actually why you want to increase the budget, what is that increase being spent on? And then the same thing happens if you take it down a level. That I don't think, you know, obviously in lots of committee discussions we'll talk about things like the MPF. The MPF is described within government as, you know, its North Star. And I always really torture this cliche, so I apologise in advance. But, you know, North Stars are good. If I get lost, I can follow the North Star and have a good idea of where I'm going. But it still doesn't mean that I don't run the risk of falling off a cliff unless I actually know what my route is. So it's fine to have that kind of big national level macro North Star to follow, but you need to know what your route map is. And again, I don't think actually we've got that lower level, you know, whatever you want to term them, outside of kind of targets that have either been set nationally. I'm not sure if we kind of know where we're going yet.
Mm. Okay, that's helpful. Thank you.
Thank you. Sorry, yes, of course.
Thank you. So just on the back of the budgets and data, the Scottish Women's Budget Group would support a review into the integration of health and social care and how this is working, particularly in relation to shared budgets and the impact that decisions being taken in relation to social care influence health and social and other services. So, for example, East Lothian Council clearly stated in their budget papers for this year that the increased funding they got for wage rises would not be passed onto the Integration Joint Board. In addition, Glasgow Integration Joint Board has had to make 21 million of cuts to its budget, with budget papers recognising that this will increase the waiting list for those who need care packages, reduce day care services and care home beds, and may lead to failure to meet statutory duties. So again, this suggests that there is a continuation of looking at things in silos, which means that the consequences of decisions do not consider the bigger picture in the long term as well.
Evelyn Tweed.
Thanks, convener. Good morning, panel. Thanks for your contribution so far. In our call for views, a number of respondents said that there was a need for public engagement in relation to health and social care spending and the choices that need to be made. Do you think this is a good idea, generally? And also, how can it be done well to make sure that we do not increase people's expectations maybe in the wrong way? And to anyone that would like to come in.
Again, I'm really sorry, but we don't comment on those kinds of issues.
We think that, yeah, there probably needs to be a conversation as to what people expect from health and from care, and probably taxation needs to be included as part of that conversation. And following on from previous questions, there might be a conversation as well as to how we empower people as well to think about their health and what choices can be made, for example, talking about foods earlier. As to how you do it, we don't really have a view because we haven't engaged with that, but we are happy to discuss with our members and get back to you.
Yeah, I think so. It's a good thing. I think one of the things I often come back to that I often think about, and how do you fix it? And actually, it comes back to this shift of where do you deliver care? The redesign of urgent care that we went through over the last few years, and you know, you could argue whether or not that was a very grand title for what the reforms actually were. But if you take just one, you know, for example, the advice to not present at A&E, and actually here's a number that you can ring, and they will triage you. And then, you know, you could then determine whether or not you need to present at A&E to try and reduce A&E numbers down for obvious reasons. But again, actually recognising that quite often you don't need to go into a secondary setting, that there will be other avenues of support. So that is, you know, if you want to talk about shifting the balance of care, that is absolutely the appropriate kind of thing to do. And that was the right thing to do. But it was uproar. You know, there was, you know, people thought they were being told, because there's this expectation that, or not an expectation, but obviously the way we talk about the health service, that is a national service and it's a right and it's an entitlement. So, you know, there's uproar that people are being told not to go to A&E, that obviously, you know, political attention paid to it, public weren't too sure what to do. So you could argue that kind of the way that was gone about and communicated and the way people were engaged with was wrong. But I think it just highlights a kind of tension that we sometimes have in this, that people want more GPs, people want to be able to see their GP, but at the same time, actually, you know, obviously want to be able to go to A&E any time of day, we know, with whatever ailment they have. But I think that's part of the problem, that we need to be able to actually have that grown-up discussion of what is the health system for? What are the individual bits of the health system for? How do you access them? And actually, is the way it's set up right now appropriate? Because if you take something like, you know, that change to advice around presenting at A&E, the kind of, the way it was viewed and the kind of, the way it was perceived, certainly I don't think bore any relation to actually what the reform was trying to do, and there's potentially fault on all sides for that. But I think it provides a really useful microcosm of actually, I don't think we're yet able to have that kind of grown-up debate about alternative models of care, because even something like that, you know, caused untold amounts of anguish and upset.
So to come back on some of those points, so generally it's felt to be a good idea, there should be an open and transparent conversation with the public about health and social care and how we move forward with it. But from the comment you're making, it's maybe not going to be that easy. It's going to have to be very well thought out.
I think, you know, the NHS is absolutely the jewel crown of public services, and that applies right across the UK. That means that people have a huge emotional attachment to it, as none of you will be strangers to. It is often the very largest political football that gets batted around. That's, footballs don't get batted around, so that was a bad metaphor to use. But so on both sides, there is huge public attachment, and on the other side, there is huge public pressure, attention, everything. So on both sides, something has to give there, I think. And that is incredibly difficult. It's very easy for me to sit here and say, because I have got no solutions for how you do that. But something has to give that we're able to kind of start thinking about how the system is set up and designed and delivered. Because if we don't, we're going to persist with this model that is chewing up resources in secondary and still not delivering the care and communities that people need in primary. Mm-hmm.
I was just going to make a comment. I think the comments that you've made have been very good, and I would agree that these conversations sometimes are difficult because the public are thinking about things in a different way. But I think in some of the communications that I saw going out from the government about, say, social prescribing, multidisciplinary teams, it made people start talking about it. It made people start having a conversation with each other about how we do things better. So I think we've got to do it, even if it's difficult. Thank you.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. I will be quick. I'm thinking about community pharmacy as another way to direct people. So Pharmacy First, for instance, and then there's also our national treatment centres that have been established so that elective surgery can be done so that emergency beds are not taking up the space for elective patients. So that's something that has been done. I feel like we're spinning plates sometimes, and none of this is an overnight fix. Like I used the example of Peter Pekka, Professor Pekka Puska, sorry, in Finland. It was 3 decades for him to reduce the mortality of the men from cardiovascular disease by 80%, but they made that approach. So I suppose my question is that, you know, is the Scottish Government going in the right direction when it comes to budget choices and health choices, and on the back of Evelyn's question, making helping people manage expectations as well?
I think the Scottish Government has... They do know what the issues are, and I think they have kind of like taken some good steps, but maybe the issues also come when it comes to implementation, for example, or to evaluation of some of the initiatives. I'm thinking just now about the Women's Health Plan. So this was approved, I think, a year or 2 years ago, and it was meant to be funded with the COVID-19 recovery funds. However, we have, for example, we have submitted some freedom of information requests to some boards, and two have come back to us. Lothian, for example, saying that no specific central funding attached to the Women's Health Plan has been allocated to delivering the priorities, aims and the actions in Lothian. And Highland has got back to us saying that they are still trying to ascertain if they have the information to provide a response to our requests. So from this example, we could say that, yes, they have taken some steps and they have identified a need to decrease health inequalities and to look at women's health. However, because there is not a budget attached to it, we don't know how successful that plan will be. So I suppose in conclusion, there's more that could be done.
So I suppose, is that like an NHS board's responsibility to deliver what the government has a plan, but the NHS board would be the one delivering the Women's Health Plan, for instance, in NHS Lothian area, and so measuring that is something that NHS Lothian will would propose that they would monitor how their plan has been delivered and what outcomes they've achieved.
Yeah, I suppose, but because the plan comes from Scottish Government, I suppose there will be some sort of way to measure this or to follow up.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Thank you. And we'll move on to our final theme, Antandish Kohani.
Thank you. This is a question for Sir David, but Philip, you started by saying that there was an opacity into seeing the spending in primary care. So my question, Professor, is data sufficiently transparent regarding specific Scottish Government commitments, such as mental health commitments, regarding the budget, so that we can effectively monitor it?
Okay, I keep on apologising to you because, as I say, we do not forecast spending on health, so we don't go down to the level of detail to know what is available in the way of data in order to produce forecasts for health spending. So I'm just not able to comment on the adequacy of the data here. We just don't forecast health. The projections we did for the fiscal sustainability report, we did draw on some data about the breakdown into spending in primary, secondary healthcare. So we had some kind of data in order to make our projections, but these are pretty rough and ready figures we used, and we were just doing long-term projections starting from that starting point. When we do our budget forecasts on income tax and on social security, we have much, much more detailed data which we use to feed into our forecast. And we spent a lot of time working with both HMRC and with Social Security Scotland to make sure we have the data to do our forecast. And every year we publish a statement of data needs, of where we still think there are gaps in the data that we need in order to do our forecasts better and improve the accuracy of our forecasts. But because we don't forecast health spending, we've never ever published a statement of data needs in relationship to health data.
Okay. So my second question is to Carmen. So I think social care is often seen sort of as a Cinderella service whose sole job it is to prop up the NHS, allow speedy discharges, allow hospitals to work more efficiently, but it needs to be seen as a vital part of care that we have. So when it comes to looking at how social care and the social care data is used to see what we can do, how we can make improvements, do you think we have adequate data when it comes to social care? And if not, what do you think is missing?
I don't think I'm going to be able to give you the detail as to what is missing right now, but I can get back to you after this. But there is definitely some data missing, because when we issued our reports, we had to base some estimations on data from England. So there is definitely a gap. Going back to your previous question about data, what is missing or not, Audit Scotland published this month a report on adult mental health and has made remarks about the complexity of the current system and how it makes it more difficult to develop and provide person-centred services. So there are multiple organisations involved in the planning, in funding and provided adult mental health services, including the integration joint boards, health and social care professionals, NHS, councils and third sector organisations. So again, sometimes trying to get data from this is quite complicated. And there was a recommendation, going back to the point that I made earlier, about how the Scottish Government should work with NHS boards and the integration joint boards to improve accountability arrangements. And again, in terms of data and budgets, we know that most of the, there is these integrations about health and care, but most of the budget usually goes to health. So there is, again, like for social care, we still, we would say that it's still underfunded and undervalued, and that this needs to be tackled and improved so we could get greater outcomes and we could also improve prevention. It must be part of the system and be at the centre.
Thank you. And my last question is to you, Philip. So, for me, as a taxpayer, when money is spent, I think it's important we know where that money is spent, and there's an audit trail with that spending of money. Is that too simplistic a view when it comes to health, to seeing where our money is being spent and how?
So I don't think it would be simplistic. There is an issue about, I think in particular, again, if you just look at secondary, once it hits a health board's budget, it's very difficult to know what then sits beneath each individual health board's budget. That data is really difficult to find, and quite often you have to do it after the fact whenever audited accounts are produced. So, you know, there is a bit of a thing of, you know, once it's left Scottish Government budget into health boards, it should then equally be split out at a level beneath that. I think, does that tell you, it might tell you where it's being spent. I'm not sure it tells you what outcomes it's having. I definitely don't think it will tell you if it's being spent in the right way. You know, I've done this for a long time and I still couldn't tell you really. I wouldn't know where to start shifting money around. So I think data is an issue. There is issues around funding. So again, you take one commitment from government, a really good one, that 10% of all Healthline or frontline health spend will go on mental health by the end of this parliament. But again, that because that's delivered through health boards, because then it's up to health boards to determine how much money they're putting where, you've got absolutely no idea if that's being delivered, and more importantly, who's doing the heavy lifting of delivering that commitment. So things like that become impossible to track. So there's an issue of that, just transparency of where money is going. I think the more important thing is data. So data exists across multiple different sources. It's incredibly difficult to find. Even if you do find it, quite often it's not made user-friendly. Like, yeah, I don't think on both transparency and data, I think every committee actually is probably doing its pre-budget scrutiny and beyond is probably having a very similar discussion because it's not unique to health. But I think because quite often health is such a complex area, it becomes kind of even more heightened, so it does. But yeah, the ultimate point is that, you know, we've got good data around, you know, outcomes around diseases, etc., etc., but being able to find that and actually genuinely understanding what's driving it, and more importantly how you can start to shift it, becomes much more difficult.
Thank you.
Can I maybe just add a point here, which is I think it's important to understand the distinction between social security spending on other forms of spending. One feature of social security spending is this is essentially demand-led spending. So once the Scottish Government has set the eligibility criteria, has set the rates of pay that it will pay for certain conditions, has set all the way in which the benefits will be delivered, the information it requires from people applying for benefits, etc., once it's set all of that, the level of spending is essentially determined by the number of people who turn up and claim those benefits. So you don't get to choose the amount of spending. That is determined by the people who claim the benefits. So it's not like there's a big...
Sorry, budget forgive me, I wasn't talking about benefits.
Sorry?
I wasn't talking about benefits.
I understand that. My point is that you don't get to choose certain elements of overall budgeting. So you don't get to choose the amount that's spent on social security. Basically, what you get to choose is how you spend the rest between health, education and other resources. The spending on social security, you determine the conditions under which people can apply, but the amount that's ultimately spent is determined by who turns up and claims that. That's why when we produce our fiscal reports, what we do is we produce the overall budget, we subtract off social security spending, and then we say there's the budget that's left to spend on everything else. So if you're going to have a discussion about are we having the right information? Are we making the right decisions about how we spend on these different areas? One area of spend you don't have the same degree of control over is Social Security.
Thank you.
Yeah, I just wanted to pick up on some of the modelling that's been done in the productivity paper that you've prepared. You know, if you take the National Health Service workforce in Scotland, it's the fourth largest city in Scotland. I think the headcount sits at 181,000 people, so the biggest employer in Scotland by a considerable distance. That clearly has an effect on national performance in terms of productivity. Do you have any thoughts on whether we can improve our analysis of the productivity of the National Health Service as a workforce and actually informing national policy?
Well, most of the work we've done on productivity is on productivity across the economy as a whole. That feeds into what's happening in the health service, but we haven't done a specific study of productivity in the health service per se. We've looked at the consequences for the health service of productivity that's taking place in the rest of the economy. And we've just published a paper where we show how different assumptions about productivity have different impacts on the overall fiscal sustainability for the Scottish economy.
We might come back to you to ask further information about the potential of doing deeper analysis on the National Health Service and its productivity. That might be something of interest to the committee. So thanks for that insight.
Okay. Thank you very much. Emma Harper, did you have a very brief?
Yeah. Yep, and I need to remind everybody that I'm a current registered nurse. I forgot to say that at the beginning. It's a quick question about economy. So normally we measure gross domestic product as a measure of how successful a country is, but we now have a wellbeing economy cabinet secretary, so we're looking at wellbeing, and we know that if we help get people out of poverty, then that supports them into maybe being more productive. And do you agree that supporting like a wellbeing economy approach is a way that we can look at how we budget for health, because it will address right across the portfolios when we're talking about housing, poverty and addressing the issues that we face in Scotland?
So the simplest answer might be, was able to get into it today, but in follow-up note, we've done a lot of research at a UK level showing exactly that, of actually what are the consequences from an economic perspective of the decline in health, and then vice versa. If we were to get a healthier population, what does that do for the economy? So I can maybe provide some of that in a note. So I don't know if Carmen particularly would say anything.
I'm not sure if I have anything to say about the well-being economy just now.
I'm asking because I'm the co-convener of the Wellbeing Economy Cross-Party Group, and we've had lots of interesting discussion around how it's good to support well-being as a nation and not just measure productivity on GDP.
I think it is important to have a healthy nation, and you know, by improving health outcomes, you might have also more people that are able to enter the labour market. Again, when we did this cost of care modelling report, we were also thinking about job creation and making the care sector more competitive and more attractive. Also, bearing in mind the number of unpaid carers in Scotland, and you know how this could help to bring people into the labour market, especially in the context of a shrinking workforce, as we know from the Fiscal Commission report. And GDP as an absolute measure of how well the economy is running, you know, it's just a measure, but it doesn't take into consideration care, for example. And we also know that, yeah, it is good to have a growing economy, or so they say, but that doesn't translate always into greater outcomes or equality or equity. So, you know, it's something that is there. But, a well-being economy might measure success in a way that is more appropriate, considering the policy commitments.
OK, thanks.
Thank you. So thank the witnesses for their evidence to committee this morning. The next item on our agenda is consideration of one negative instrument, the Personal Injuries NHS Charges Amounts Scotland Amendment No. 2, Regulations 2023. The purpose of the instrument is to increase the charges recovered from persons who pay compensation in cases where an injured person receives National Health Service hospital treatment or ambulance services. The increase in charges relates to an uplift for Hospital and Community Health Service HCHS inflation. And the policy note states that the NHS charges are revised annually from the 1st of April to take account of Hospital and Community Health Services pay and price inflation. The last revision took effect on the 1st of April 2023, applying the estimate for HCHS inflation at the time of 2.8%. As a result of subsequent NHS pay deals, and the latest estimate for HCHS inflation is 5.3%, and this mid-year tariff uplift addresses a significant gap between the forecast and actual pay inflation. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered the instrument at its meeting on the 12th of September 2023 and made no recommendations in regard to this instrument, and no motion to annul has been received in relation to this instrument. Do members have any comments? No? OK. I propose that the committee does not make any recommendations in relation to this negative instrument. Do members agree, disagree with this? No? OK. Our next meeting of the committee will briefly consider a negative instrument, and this will be followed by a joint meeting of selected members of the Health, Social Care and Sport, Social Justice and Social Security and Criminal Justice Committees to scrutinise drug policy. At our meeting on the 3rd of October, the committee will receive an update from the Minister for Social Care, Mental Wellbeing and Sport on the National Care Service Scotland Bill, and we'll continue our pre-budget scrutiny. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today.